newspaper.
Huh?
Read the newspaper. Keeper, weeper, chimney sweeper, had a wife, but couldn't keep her. Had another name, love of the chimney, he didn't stop.
No, I say I got me 8 more new.
I'd say
even more than Maris. If there's a daughter town, I think I'm not taking to Paris.
The missus wants to open up a castle by the sea.
The doctor recommends a quiet summer by the sea.
All I want is a own somewhere, far away from the cold night air. With lots of chocolate for me to eat. Lots of cold, making lots of eight. Wolfing, 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 and wolfing, making
lovely. Oh, so lovely, sitting apps of bloom and blue. We still, I would never blush till spring. Wrapped up in the windowsill, go to what the cake, what tea, a mom and dad buying it for me. Who take good care of me, oh, wouldn't it be lovely, lovely, lovely.
Afternoon, Mary.
Good afternoon, George.
Everybody, put your toys away. Time to go get yours. No blowing horns in the house. How was the meeting?
It could have been a telegram.
But what did they say?
They said we're raising the poor above their natural station.
But what about work with the children?
They seem more concerned that their position as a higher class would be threatened if the lower class started improving.
Well, surely they don't begrudge the orphans a safe place to stay.
Oh no, they spoke broadly, criticizing our work, not only with the education of the poor, but with our evangelical crusades, and of the printing work we do. They even challenged me on my support of our friend Taylor.
Hudson?
It was just an attempt from those who don't support our work to discourage me. But I take it as affirmation, as a blessing.
A blessing? How could such a thoughtful word be a blessing?
Anytime there's opposition, Mary, it means you're doing something right. The path of Jesus is a way littered with attempts to dishearten us, discourage us, and defeat us. Now that was good alliteration. Have we any paper, wife? Sunday's sermon is still waiting to be written.
Sunday sermon? What of Tuesday's sermon?
Tuesday? How many sermons am I scheduled to preach this week?
Just 3 at last count. But Moody mentioned he might need to take Friday nights as well.
Disheartened, discouraged. 4 sermons?
Well, don't let that disheartened, discouraged defeat you. God has given you so many opportunities to bless Bristol with your brilliant benedictions.
What a blessing. Mary, do you remember why we started this home way back during the cholera outbreak?
It started long before the cholera outbreak, George.
Well, yes, you're right. Remember when Elijah died?
It started long before Elijah's death, George. Remember when we got married?
Was that before or after you discovered I was gifted with alliteration?
Oh, I always knew you were greatly gifted with garrulous grace. And then Lydia came.
Our first daughter. Little did I know I would have 30 more 7 years later.
George. And then Elijah was born.
And then he was taken from us.
Did you ever wonder why God didn't answer our prayers for Elijah's feelings?
Sometimes, yes. My human heart wrestled with his death. But Mary, we aren't responsible for God's answers. We are responsible to ask and to trust that our Father hears us and will walk with us, no matter what answer he gives us.
Yes, I know. But trusting God can't remove the ache.
No, nothing can really take that away. But we were never promised that life wouldn't ache. Just that we have a companion who walks with us through the grief we felt. And he did, Mary.
He did.
And then came the cholera outbreak and so many children lost their families. We saw that something must be done.
Our day schools couldn't truly meet the poor orphans' needs. And we decided to open our home to them.
All 30 of them, yes. Even though we hardly had 2 shillings to our name.
Those were such happy days, George. Remember those 30 girls and how full our life was with love and laughter and song?
Everyone to their evil
to our Father, sleep well tonight. Don't let the bell call the silent tree calls. Sleep well, don't forget to say your prayer.
Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I shall die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take.
Good night, girls.
Good night, Mrs. Wheeler.
But why'd you bring it up?
Because those men today, they think we do this for the orphans.
We don't?
No. It's never been about the orphans. We opened our home to the girls because we wanted to give God a main stage, so to speak, to show that he may be trusted to supply the practical affairs of life.
That's why we so often don't know what we'll be getting for food in the morning when we rise.
We're just an example God uses that he might strengthen the faith of his children as they watch him meet our needs.
That's why those men today don't bother you?
They suppose that we're working for the orphans, but they see only a small part of our purpose here in Bristol.
I suppose you're right.
Of course I'm right. We exist to show Bristol, and perhaps the world, that our Father can be trusted with the practical affairs of life.
Speaking of practical affairs of life, George, then what's time for evening prayers?
You don't want to hear the rest of my sermon now. I was just really getting started.
By the way this week is going, I'll have four sermons by the time the week's out. Here, quickly drink this before the children come running in. You'll be tired by the fireplace.
Mary, what was the phrase I was going to say for Sunday?
Disheartened, discouraged, defeat.
Oh, yes.
No blowing horns in the house. How many times? Seriously. Walter Thomas, stop fighting.
You know how many more days to Christmas, Mr. Beulah?
Christmas, Edward?
Will we have stockings this year?
Stockings? How on earth can we fit 126 stockings on our mantelpiece?
Will we have mincemeat pie?
Or a pumpkin?
Will we have a tree?
All excellent questions. Edward, how many days until Christmas?
19 more. 19.
And the rest of you, how can I tell you what the Lord will provide for us in 19 days from now? If you want stockings, Jenny, then who should you ask? Not me.
Our Father in heaven.
That's right. And how can you listen for his answer? Where should you be? Why should you be with him, Catherine?
So he can hear his answer.
So you can hear his answer. And Clara, how can you be with your Father?
Through prayer.
Yes, that's true. But how is the best way to hear what your Father wants to tell you?
By reading his word.
That's right. You've all learned well. And in the meantime, as we wait, what shall we sing? All right. Charles, which carol would you like to sing? All right. Silent Night.
Thank you.
children. And then, Edward, how many more days until Christmas? 6 seconds apiece until they begin to call for a drink of water.
Mr. Mueller, can I have a drink?
I'll wrestle with their questions, George. Annie just now told me that she thinks Todd is lazy. We know he isn't, but I understand why she asked those questions. I too wrestle with it. She wants a family so badly. Why doesn't God give one for her? We know he could. I know they're just children, but sometimes those simple questions almost stump me. I myself don't know the answers to the questions.
There are no answers, Mary. These questions, these struggles that we and each of our children face, they're too hard for answers. Why would a loving God allow her to lose her parents or any of these precious children to go through any of the challenges they face? There is no answer good enough for the pain they've experienced. But Mary, God doesn't give us answers in this life. He himself is the answer. No answer can satisfy our questions but the presence of our Heavenly Father.
But even the presence of God can't remove the ache.
No, it doesn't take it away, but the presence of God enables us to better carry it.
I understand. Jesus doesn't always calm the storms, like he did for the disciples.
Not always. But he calms his children and enables us with the strength to face our storms.
But then, what answer do we give to little Annie's?
I suppose it's like the blind beggar in the Gospel of John. When he was asked how Jesus could perform such a miracle, he replied, "I don't know, but one thing I do know, I was blind and now I see."
I understand. So, we declare that we know him, not that we understand what he's saying. I guess perhaps one day we'll understand.
I know one thing I'd like to understand one day, Mary.
What's that?
I'd like to know what Alice did to that mutton tonight. I almost envied the ram.
The ram?
At least he was already dead. Unlike the rest of us, choking on his charred remains.
Cooking doesn't seem to be very common gifting amongst our girls.
Neither does horn tooting, but that doesn't seem to stop Anna and her crew from trying.
Called this meeting to discuss the Mueller's work with the orphans. I understand there's an issue with the bomb.
Well, that's just one of the issues.
As soon as lines have been running underground and getting backed up, I can't imagine how pleasant they're on. That's crazy.
Then there's the issue of noise. The Mueller's make mostly happy noises, but there's still noises.
I understand the points. We all appreciate the Mueller's and what they're doing. But we do have a problem.
Wilson Street would be better off without the orphans.
Well, we can't just turn them out.
Why ever not? George and his wife are doing good work.
No,
but
no.
Listen. We're not going to go through anybody out of the street, but we can't all talk at once. Ladies, please sit down. George and Mary are doing the Lord's work, but we do have a common problem. What are we going to do about it?
They find a child running wild and try to bring her home.
As if they don't have quite enough for children of their own.
Then if you ask the king, you always like an academe.
They'll ask the boys and teachers who they be.
They're always causing problems, but their love for them is real.
They're always hogging up our dreams,
but really, what's the deal? I hate to have to say it, but I very firmly feel the Mueller's no longer across the street.
I want to say what I meant at once.
Oh, please, Mrs. Morgan, don't be dense.
Have you solved a problem like the Mueller's? Rescued every single child in town. Have you found a way to try to tell them?
things are simple, they make sense to me. Feel about your worries and your stress. Let's pretend it's home to me and you, cause no one needs no friends.
Good morning, my friend.
I heard you had quite the meeting yesterday, and I wanted to hear about it from you and not from Mrs. Wilson.
Oh yes, my meeting. They accuse me, well, us, of attempting to raise the poor above their natural station in life.
What's of it? That's exactly what you're doing. It's what we're all doing. In our work with the chapels, the education work we did, and in our support of the mission throughout the world. They accuse us of accomplishing exactly what we set out to do.
Mary and I were discussing yesterday why we opened the children's home.
To care for the orphans during the plague, no?
Well, yes, but you know as well as I do, Henry, that this orphanage exists more to prove that God can supply the need of his children.
That's what you and I preach, George. Take Anthony.
My brother.
Yes, your brother. He used to be a dentist, and now he's traveling the globe. Rest in peace.
He's been working in India.
Ah, yes, India. I remember back in the day when I tutored for him. That was before I met you, George, and before you met Mary, okay?
And a good thing. I was only 21 in 1826. I was still in my infancy as a new believer.
And how old was Mary in 1826?
Now, Henry, I was 28, but George was 25 when we got married.
Still 7 years your junior, yes?
I know that was doing.
You were always out of my league. I couldn't even preach a sermon in 1830 without stumbling over my English words.
You Prussians sure have a way of mangling your words up.
Oh, but not these days, Henry. You should have heard him alliterating yesterday.
Oh, alliteration. Very nice.
Yes, well, you were saying, Anthony.
Ah, yes, Anthony. You know his passion, that missionaries should never publish their needs, but trust in God to provide for them.
Which God has always done for us. Usually not from the very last minute, but he's kept us constantly dependent on him.
So your point is, Anthony?
My point is that all of us exist to serve God however he's called us individually. Anthony with his Indians, you with your orphans, and you with the chapels. We all exist to prove that God can be trusted with the practical matters of life.
And it's not just that, Henry. We're never responsible for God's answers. We are responsible, though, to ask. How can he show himself to be the faithful father we know him to be if we never ask him? If we never ask him, how can he answer?
If we never give him an opportunity to respond, how can he show his response?
Which is what you and I preach, George. We are not responsible for how God answers our prayers, but we are responsible to ask and for what we do in the meantime.
This is why it's so important that we spend time in the scriptures, familiarizing ourselves with God's words.
Thank you.
more tea, Mary?
We came out this morning to talk about the orphans in the world.
My orphans, Mrs. Small?
Yes. Have you noticed anyone else in this neighborhood with orphans, Mr. Mueller?
Well, Mrs. Wilson, you're right. We are the only ones with orphans. What about our orphans, Harris?
We all know what you're doing to get them. And all of a sudden,
some of us like having you here.
We like having you here, Mr. Mueller, but the neighbors have been complaining, mostly about the plumbing issue we've been having. We don't know what to make for relief, but we think it'd be better off building your orphan homes elsewhere. We wrote you up a letter.
I think I understand your reasons, friends, and I thank you for delivering us this letter.
It's not that we want you out. We're just concerned about the street, that's all.
We understand, Mr. Harris.
Thank you for the tea, Mary.
Of course.
Thank you for coming over.
Well, what now?
Well, I say the Lord has a new problem on his hands. They have a point. What was the last count, Mary?
126.
126 plus the three of us? That many orphans are bound to back up the pipes. Even though we do use several houses on this block, they're right in complaining.
Well, like you said, George, it's not your problem, it's God's. These are his orphans and this is his orphanage.
You're absolutely right. We'll let God decide what to do with his neighbors. Well, Lord, you heard what the neighbors have to say. You know what our children and staff need. You know how the pipes have been getting backed up, and you know how badly we need a new building. I guess you sent this letter just yourself, just to provide a new building for us.
Be they your children, Lord, and we come to you as your servants, asking you for our need. We need a new building. Even our neighbors, understanding as they are, feel that we should move our home elsewhere.
Understanding as some of them are.
Yes. Maybe we should ask you for a more understanding heart for our dear Mrs. Wilson.
We are here, Lord, during your mission, caring for your children. Your children need a new home, and we trust in you to fill this need.
We ask that you provide for this need, Lord, and that you give the neighbors, especially Mrs. Wilson, grace in the meantime. Amen. Well, I'm going down to the chapel with Henry. You can send the older boys down to help with distribution in the afternoon.
Yes.
back from the chapel this afternoon.
But did he stay in jail?
He stayed in jail long enough to teach him a good lesson. Now, is there anything else that Cook wants to tell me besides the flower jury situation?
No.
No.
All right. No. Debbie, go ahead to Cook. I'm sure she's anxiously waiting your chat. I really like Father. I like our house. With enough food, enough clothes, that I never have to turn away another orphan again. I know it's no shame to be poor. That's no great honor either. So would it have been so terrible if I had such a small fortune? If I were a rich girl,
home?
Yes. I wonder why.
I'm sure I don't know why. He's not coming for me, Anne. And you know as well as I do that Miss Paget asked him to come.
Miss Paget?
Miss Paget asked you to go to Baltimore to preach.
Yes.
Every week, did she?
There are many opportunities in Baltimore.
Opportunities aren't the only thing in Baltimore, George.
You know I'm not looking for a wife, and I can serve the Lord better than I'm not looking for a wife.
Peter the Apostle was married.
Well, look where that got him. He's dead.
So Judas, and we never heard about his wife.
Don't be ridiculous, Henry.
Well then, what's the real problem, George?
I have been praying and praying. Every time I do, I can't stop saying to God. Very good.
And what's the issue?
Mr. Hayes.
Mr. Hake, how can I leave Mr. Hake? He needs me, Anne.
He needs you?
You know how sick his wife is, and Mr. Hake works so hard at the boarding school. I couldn't just leave the Hakes.
My dear sister, you know you aren't responsible for the Hakes.
But God called me here, Anne. I couldn't just run off on them for some men.
Oh, Mary.
I can never understand. What would they do without me? This house is so big, and Mrs. Hake is so sick. She couldn't just laugh off to me. I can never...
George!
Mary!
Do you love her?
Do you love him, Mary?
Yes.
I do. Then what makes you think God can provide a replacement for Miss Groves?
Replacement?
If the Lord wants to be united in his service, he can provide the Hakes on his own.
Yes, I suppose he could.
Yeah, I suppose he could.
Finally. Well then, ma'am, why don't you pray about it?
Yes, I suppose I will.
I'll leave you to it, then.
If the Lord wants you two to be together, he can provide for the Hakes.
And if he doesn't want us together, he can say no, and I'll stay here.
Yes, what a fantastic idea.
Thank you, Ben.
Of course, now get at it.
All those days, as I ran this household, all those years, wanting something more. All that time, never even knowing what you have in store. All those days, since I came to know you. All this time, trying to find your will. Standing here, a follower, whatever you will. So I ask you for a sign, if you want me to pursue this, if you want me with this man, would you bring me a replacement? Could you bring the hay someone to take the place? Be together, give this all to I'm
Give him land some space. Welcome home, dear.
Jacob, get your things and clean them up.
What are all these? Yes, I guess I did.
Have you been praying for your goose, Thomas?
No.
Well, Walter, have you been praying for your mincemeat pies?
Well, no.
Maybe we should get started.
Well, dear Lord, we're coming now to ask for mincemeat pies next week.
And we know you're busy, Lord. The Christmas feast is looking bleak.
Could you send a goose or two? But it's really up to you.
Could you send us lots to eat this Christmas?
Well, we're here. A few more things. I'd really like another cat. And dear Lord, I don't have wings. The skates could really help with that.
So we ask to sing your name.
And your goodness is unchanged.
If you bring us gifts or not.
But I guess you really hit the spot.
How many more days till Christmas, Edward? Don't all talk at once. What is it, William?
Mrs. Mueller told us you got
to
go to jail.
Did she now?
And you disobeyed your mother? Who's the cop?
You
stole from your dad.
Oh, now this is an interesting story. Why don't you let me tell the boys, Mueller?
Yes, please, please.
Maybe after supper I'll tell you the story. But first, We have something to talk about. The neighbors are concerned about the number of people on this small street, and they have a point. She decided that it may be time for us to leave Wilson Street. Well, we don't know yet, Alice.
We should pray about it.
Exactly right, Laura. And what are we going to do while we wait for his answer? That's right, and what are we going to do to listen for his answer? That's right. Thomas, would you read Psalm 84, 3 and 4 to us?
Yea, the sparrow have found a house and the swallow nest for herself, where she may lay her young, even thine altars. O Lord of hosts, my King and my God, blessed are they that dwell in the house and will be still praising thee.
This psalm says that God provides homes for even the sparrows, and we're his children. To provide for us too. So we're going to put this jar right here and watch as God brings us a new home. We're going to put it over there and as God brings us the money until we're ready to move. Now then, off to supper. Plans, Bradford. That's turned out to be far better than what we have here on Wilson Street. How much is the charge?
Oh, no, I feel as if God wants to do this for free.
Oh, but Bradford, you put so much work into this. The amount of hours you put in these plans, I couldn't. Thank you, Bradford. We appreciate it.
Of course. When can we start construction?
Well,
how about this afternoon?
I'll count the boys up right after dinner, and we'll get started right away.
things ever seem to me. To depend on our God to supply our needs. Every day he's awake with himself and blessing. And we'll follow wherever he leads.
Cause every night I'm minded, I'm warm and safe and I'm fitted. And that's how my life has always been. How my world has changed, and yes, I know it may seem strange. Step aside, ladies and gentlemen. Questions, we're ready to begin.
There's a house I long to build. Everything inside is built. And the child's on his own. I've gone through growth and finished up. Now it's here, I'll touch them now. As the downs wear on. Though it seems, though it seems completely crazy. Yet we know that you know to show us more. He can bring all we need to provide all our needs. As we watched him do it once before. Hey, every night I lie to bed. We're born and safe and I can sweat. And that's how our words have always been. We think of how our build is all. And let us hear the
I'm gonna do.